Our next speaker will be Dr. Will Williams.
Good afternoon, class. I really enjoyed that. And before I get into my little discourse, I'd like to preface a couple of statements with something first. I'd like to get 1 Corinthians 12:1.
Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant.
Now here's Paul. He's talking to a group of folks. He said, now look, now concerning spiritual gifts, and they do exist. Mm-hmm. I don't want you to be ignorant of this. In other words, do not ignore what I'm getting ready to tell you about them. Read.
Ye know that ye were heathen.
Now you know, and that includes all of you.
And me as well. Before we knew anything about this doctrine, we were all heathens.
Right.
Ignorant. Savage even. Unknowing, stupid, dense, as the British would say, thick as a brick. Read.
Carried away unto these dumb idols.
Now you were carried away by all these dumb idols.
You worshipped everything. Alright? Whatever it was, I mean, hey, just take a pick. The sun, moon, and stars, the animals, the trees. You even worshipped yourself. Because you were a dumb idol too. All right, read.
Even as you were led.
Hey, even as you were led.
Okay, thank you. I just need to speak loud. Okay, go ahead.
Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of Yahweh calleth Yahshua accursed.
Now, nobody that speaks by the Spirit of Yahweh, see, you can't call Yahshua accursed. In other words, you can't come up and say, well, he doesn't know nothing, or this ain't the Savior, this is not, it's impossible. It's impossible for you, if you are truly filled with the Holy Spirit or you've been made conscious of that, for you to get up here and say something detrimental about Yahshua Messiah, in no matter what state. It's impossible for you to say so. Read.
And that no man can say that Yahshua is the Savior but by the Holy Spirit.
Read.
Now there are diversities of gifts.
Now there's diversities of gifts. Why is that?
Well, look, you have diversities of gifts. Your physical body has diversities of gifts. It's got a reproductive system, that's a gift. It's got a respiratory system, that's a gift. See, it's got a nervous system, that's a gift. Got an endocrine system, that's a gift. Got a skeletal system, that's a gift. Got a digestive system, that's a gift. And these gifts, I mean, did you create it? Do you understand? So obviously it was given to you as a gift by some higher power. Read.
But it's the same spirit.
See, in other words, let's look at it like this. The brain. This is a type of a cloud. See, you got 9 systems, but it's the brain from where it all emanates from. All the systems emanate from here. Read.
And there are differences of administrations, but the same Elohim.
It's the same Elohim. Read.
And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same Elohim which worketh all in all.
See, read.
But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal.
Now that's given to everybody. I
use the analogy of the physical body just to show you what it's like in the Spirit. And see, for somebody, because I've heard people say this, well, you know, Yahweh ain't showed me nothing. Yahweh ain't gave me no gifts. Yahweh ain't gave me talent because I can't draw a chart, or I can't write a paper, or I can't stand up here and oratize like certain other folks. You know, Yahweh has given you gifts.
Right.
He has spared none. I mean, for him not to, see, that would make him a respecter of persons. And he most definitely is not that. Read.
For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom.
Read.
To another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit. To another the gifts of healing by the same Spirit. To another the working of miracles. To another prophecy. To another discerning of spirits. To another various kinds of tongues. To another the interpretation of tongues. Mm-hmm. But all these worketh that one and the self same Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will.
That's it. Everybody has that. Bar none. Bar none. So that's why Yahweh doesn't have, that's why you don't have an excuse. but not to know Yahweh. That's why Yahweh is justified in sending you to the lake. If you choose not to use the gifts and talents that he's given you. That's for real. If you choose not to use the gifts and talents Yahweh's given you, he is justified in sending you to the lake. He's more than justified. More than justified. If you choose, because see, it's not about free will, it's about a free choice. If you choose not to use that, hey, then you have chosen. You've chosen the alternative. As Dr. Kelly would say, look, you know, you may as well just go on and get it over with now. Make your peace now or get right or whatever. You know, do it now because later you will have to abide by the consequences. It's just that simple. It really is. Now, I had that ready because I wanted to say this, that, and I don't know, maybe some people may like it, may not like it. Don't matter because it's the truth. For the last 20, 25 years or so, there's been a great stagnation in this organization. People have forgotten many of the basic fundamental principles of this doctrine.
That's right.
And because of that, man, boy, we went to this board meeting, and a comment was said about cancer. It was made, you know. It wasn't pointing fingers directly. It's what one guy I used to know called dry snitching, you know. Or signifying where I come from, you know. Saying something in a roundabout way, but you're really talking about them even though they're right in front of you. You know, signifying. And seeing where I come from, you can get killed over that because signifying worse than stealing. You know? And so it was said about a cancer, you know, being, you know, in the body, this, that, and the other, you know, a cancer growing in the body. Well, I had to look at it like this. I said, well, look, what is the cancer? See, now what we're talking about, and I know that it's signified against us, Ontario class, and not just us, but others as well. See, now you want to, now I just ask this. What we're preaching, and some of these same others, they're preaching, is the things that's based on what our founder has laid out. Okay, so now we've been around. Now, so my question is here, cancer, you're not born with cancer, you're born with a body first. Cancer comes later.
Right.
So my question is this, which came first, what we're talking about or what you're talking about?
Yeah.
See, now which is the cancer? Now I postulate this, if we're not the cancer and if we're talking what Dr. Kinley is talking, and I mean if we're saying the true thing according to the Holy Spirit, then we are the cure. We are the antidote.
There you go.
That's why we don't care if you come in here and you preach. That's why we have this policy. And that was one of the things that made me glad about this class when I first came here. And it was Joe Williams that told me this. He said, man, he said, you can preach anything you want as long as you prove it. And when he said, that was like, that was the most welcoming statement I have ever heard. That's why I've been here for over 10 years. Because people who know me, and Joe knows me from way back, you know, when this class got started, I go anywhere, I come and go as I please. I used to come in and visit, you know, this is about, I'm talking about back in 88, 89, 90 when this class got started. I used to come through it just like some of y'all do today. Come to class, whether well, these don't see you no more for 3 or 4 months. I used to do that. That's why he's laughing, because he knows it's true. See, until I had to learn and understand and say, hey, you know, true love is not abandoning somebody, because it's easy to leave something and go off somewhere.
There you go.
See, it's easy. It's easy to run away. I've done it myself. Just say, oh, screw it. Walk out the door and say, hey, later for these folks. They're a bunch of bums. It's easy to do that. But you have to have love to stay. And I mean, look, and I know some people might think we want to get away, get out of this class. Hey, we wouldn't want to leave this organization no more than a doctor want to leave a critically ill patient.
That's right.
That's just how we feel about it. See? And the things that are revealed now is not nothing new. It's all within the scope of what we wouldn't have known nothing had the seventh angel been made manifest to us.
That's right.
And that's all the credit I give, no matter what I learn in this doctrine, I give it to him. Because I wouldn't have known nothing. And others who he has influenced by the Holy Spirit, because others have done things, man. I mean, like, a man just passed away, Peter Godot. And that guy wrote a paper, man, that to this day is my inspiration on a certain subject. And that's 2520. I wouldn't know nothing about it if he hadn't written it. Mm-hmm. And look, his work was rejected by the board, too. Mm-hmm. They said, no, we don't want you, you know, go do it on your own. Publish it on your own. We don't want to be a part of it. Mm-hmm. But I didn't reject it because I knew when I read it, it was vital pattern. It was the thing Yahweh had showed him. Okay? Now, another scripture we can push on, because I know I'm running out of time. Romans 1:19-20. That's what I want.
Romans 1:19 and 20. Mm-hmm. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them, for Yahweh hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
Now we've heard this. I'm looking around and there's no strangers in here.
We've heard this scripture a million times.
Yeah.
You know, it takes the natural things to understand the invisible.
That's right.
It takes the physical things. I mean, we look at the physical to understand the spiritual because they're reflections of that. Okay? Even his supernal nature, which was already explained about the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. And it was also explained about his eternal power, too. Because you want to say, well, what is Yahweh's eternal power? It's the power of transmutation.
Yeah, right.
Now, if you're going to sit up and say, well, Yahweh's always in shape and form, what you have done is you have taken away his eternal power. If he doesn't transmute, how is he going to come down through the ages? And it's these little things that we've let slip over the years, you know, and people create comfort zones for themselves. Well, you know, I'm going to stay, this is my little area, I'm going to stay on that. You know, that's all they know is the name. That's all I know. You're gonna stay on that, but you don't want to grow. You don't want to progress. And I ain't talking about progress in the sense of what they're talking about. I'm talking about progress according to the steps of the tabernacle pattern. Because the goal that you want to get to is here.
Yes.
This is where you want to progress to. Is to here.
Right.
And that's the thing. So, you know, hey. So this is probably the first chart that's been made about the doctrine in about over 20 years, as far as I know. Since Burbank Mitchell used to make his charts, you know. People ain't complaining about that. And that green chart, when I first saw the green chart, that was scrambled eggs to me.
Right.
Believe you me. But Dr. Kinley never had a problem with that. As long as you could prove it, it was according to the pattern and according to the doctrine that he laid out. As long as it was like that, man, as far as I knew, man, he had no problems with it. Or for that, but not just charts, but anybody writing it. Or somebody getting up and talking about a lecture or something that nobody had never heard before. It's like, so as long as you got the pattern in mind, and that's the foundation, and it goes according to it, hey, it's the thing Yahweh set up. You know? So I'd like to continue where the last speaker left off, and I want to get comparative exegetical analysis in our textbook. That's the first volume. Or well, somewhere around. I know I ain't got much time, so I'm going to have to cut this.
Page 50.
I'm going to have to cut it.
You start at the beginning?
Like I said, I'm just have to cut to the chase. Turn to page 52. Just start at the top.
The Apostle Paul said, "For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the supernal nature of Yahweh in bodily form." Here we have the agreeable statements of the Apostles John and Paul on the structure of the Godhead. The practical scientific authority on the structure of atoms, a brief investigation of scientific data compiled on 1, the atomic, 2, the electronic, and 3, the molecular discoveries, will reveal that basically matter is composed of 1, the proton, 2, the neutron, and 3, the electron, and these 3 component parts form 1 of these atoms. In order to show the manifestations of the threefold Godhead in these 91 threefold ultramicroscopic particles of matter, our knowledge of the comparisons are as follows. A, the unity of the Spirit, the Father, the Word, the Holy Spirit. The 91 atoms, the proton, the neutron, the electron, transmutation, abstract, intermediate, concrete. The 92nd and last atomic element of matter mentioned herein is twofold. It is composed of 1, the electron, and 2, the proton. And these 2 component parts form the entire hydrogen atom. The 2 component parts of the hydrogen atom represent 1, the invisible creation, and 2, the visible creation.
Read that again.
The 2 component parts of the hydrogen atom represent 1, the invisible creation, and 2, the visible creation, both of which are embodied in Yahweh and are controlled with unerring accuracy by 3, the universal spirit law. In order to show the manifestation of the supernal nature in the 92nd and last ultra-microscopic particle of matter, our knowledge of the comparisons are as follows. The 92nd atom, the spirit law, the invisible creation, the visible creation. the supernal nature or Godhead, the Father, the Word, the Holy Spirit. The 91 atoms, abstract, intermediate, concrete. Exemplifications of the above comparisons are observed in the threefold structure of Noah's Ark, the Tabernacle of Moses, the Temple, and the migration of the Israelites, etc. It is also noteworthy that the Apostle Paul used parchments to draw the divine pattern or tabernacle of Moses and to make spiritual comparative illustrations in his teaching.
That's what we got here, parchments.
See, people, you know, just people talk about church, well, we got parchments, what's yours? See, right? And they want sheepskin too. That's what original parchments were. Okay, read.
The best way to understand the illustration of the supernal nature compared to the elements of matter and transmutation are shown in examples A and B above. It is important that the student carefully observe and remember this threefold arrangement. The best way to make the comparisons understandable are shown as follows. The most holy place, outer court. The Father, the Word, the Holy Spirit. Proton, neutron, electron, nucleolus, nucleus, cell body. If we accept the testimony of the divine and scientific authorities as the truth, we are then compelled to agree that the structure of the supernal nature and of the 91 atomic elements of matter are threefold. Likewise, we are also compelled to agree that the structure of the universe and the 92nd hydrogen atomic element of matter is twofold and embodied in the invisible third part of the supernal nature or Godhead. Whereas it is apparently evident that each and every atomic element and particle of matter embodied in the total structure of the physical creation is derived from universal spirit. In the material realm of nature, these 91 threefold atomic elements of matter, systematically formed by universal spirit law, apparently present sufficient concrete evidence to support the existence of the threefold supernal nature or Godhead.
In other words, this creation is the proof that Yahweh exists.
That's right.
You are the proof that Yahweh exists. See, and I read in a lecture just the other night that Dr. Kinley said it like this. They said, look, there can't be a creation without a God, and if there's a God, there's a purpose.
Likewise, the hydrogen atom, herein classified the 92nd and only twofold atomic element of matter, clearly manifests that the universe is composed of two distinctive parts, namely one, the invisible or incorporeal creation, and two, the visible or material creation. These are the two transmuted parts of the threefold supernal nature or Godhead. The apparent total absence of a third part in the twofold hydrogen atom, as related to the threefold supernal nature or Godhead, and the twofold universe, also has a very important significance. It reveals that the invisible or incorporeal and the visible or material parts of the universe are embodied in universal spirit, or the major invisible third part of the supernal nature or Godhead, wherein both are accurately and unerringly controlled by universal spirit law. To help you better understand.
That's good enough. I've had that read just so you know what the premise is here. Now, let me say something at this point, too. This treatise that Dr. Kinley wrote, Comparative Exegetical Analysis, he wrote this many years ago, all right, long before he even came up with a textbook, even before the 58 video. Now, Dr. Carl Gross, a name who doesn't get much airplay these days, but really an important person in the history of the school, who was really the co-founder and the very first student in this doctrine, right? Used to know a lot of folks, you know. I mean, his family was sort of, you know, they weren't rich, but they were well off. They had a business in Springfield, all right? And Dr. Gross, you know, used to give money to some of these historical black colleges, and he knew people, you know. For example, he had an acquaintance with one great scientist of the 1940s. That was George Washington Carver. I mean, man, Dr. Gross, I'm talking about the co-founder of the school, knew the man personally, all right? So Dr. Gross would take some of the papers that Dr. Kim would write, and he would submit them to these different colleges, like Wittenberg Colleges, Fisk University down in Tennessee. These are all these old black colleges. And so when they read this treatise, like compared to this exegetical analysis, they were really amazed at it. It's really an amazing piece of work when you really sit down and study it, because we're going to get into it with a little time we have left. But they came to Dr. Kinley and they said, sir, I said, man, who wrote this paper? I said, man, this is a great paper. And I said, well, I mean, what college did you? And so I graduated from college. I dropped out of sixth grade. Oh, no, you can't tell people that. We can't publish this and say that you were sixth grade. That would make us look bad as an institution. All right, look, I'll tell you what. we will confer upon you an honorary degree, a PhD, so that you, you know, so that when we put up on the paper, it'll say Henry Clifford Kinley, PhD, instead of, you know, sixth grade dropout. See? Right? Because people are not going to believe that this was written by a sixth grade dropout. And that's why we call Henry Clifford Kinley doctor. That's the very reason why. Now, if you don't, now, and people, and I've explained this to people, this treatise, and a lot of people have poo-pooed this treatise, and I just tell people this. If you don't believe what Dr. Kinley wrote in this, then you need to quit calling him a doctor. Because this is the very reason why he is Dr. Kinley. And it's a great, I mean, I remember reading this when I first came in the class. Because I read the text before I set foot in the class. That's what made me come to class, when I read this textbook. Especially this part. Because it's really amazing. Now, he talks about the 92nd Adam. Now, let's just clear some stuff here. Now, this is a periodic table of elements. I'm sure some of you might remember this from high school, general science, chemistry, whatever. And these are the elements of which this universe is made out of. Now, it's got 103 here, but they've discovered a lot more since then. In fact, it's up to about, I think, 112, maybe 114. Now, however, there are 92 natural elements. And Dr. Kinley spoke about the 92nd atom, which he classified as hydrogen. Now, we know, if you look on this chart, the 92nd atom is uranium. I mean, any chemistry student will tell you that. But this is not what Dr. Kinley's talking about. What he's talking about is this. You see that hydrogen is, I don't want to say set apart, but hydrogen is the father of all these elements.
That's right.
And because it's twofold as compared to the rest of the elements, which are threefold. Now you say, well, what's wrong? Well, why is there a distinction with hydrogen? Well, see, hydrogen is a type of this cloud. It's a type of Yahweh, pure spirit. All you got to do is look at the properties of hydrogen. It's odorless, colorless, can't see it. But you put a flame on it, it will get very explosive.
Combustion.
See, that's what Yahweh, pure spirit is. Can't see it, can't smell it, can't touch it, but it's a consuming fire.
Yes.
And he's and this is the source and substance of all of everything. Just like hydrogen is the source and substance of all these elements. It's the same thing in principle. Now, hydrogen has the ability to become isotopic. That simply means this, a variation of the original element.
That's right.
Okay? Now, here you have hydrogen. All right, and we read that hydrogen is a proton and a neutron. I mean, proton and an electron, excuse me. Then no neutron. All right, now hydrogen, now neutrons, let's explain something about particles. Protons have positive charges, all right, and they have mass and they have weight. An electron has electrical charge, but it's very small, has very little mass. A neutron has no charge either way. However, it's as big as a proton, so it has mass, therefore it has weight. So when you add a neutron to an element, of a nucleus of an atom, you may not be adding more of a charge, but you are adding more mass, and you are adding more weight. So when that happens, when a see, it's only a proton and an electron here. So now when two neutrons are added to hydrogen, it becomes an isotope, and that isotope is called deuterium. See, and if you notice, you know, like the word Deuteronomy, see, because the word deuter means second, see, or number two. So now here you got deuterium. Now that's a variation. It's a heavier element than hydrogen. Now we know that water is composed of H2O. One part hydrogen, two parts oxygen. Now, and it's drinkable. We can get a glass of water, drink it, take a bath in it. It's cool. No problem with that. However, deuterium, which is a heavier element than hydrogen, can combine with water, and it becomes D2O. Which is otherwise known as heavy water. See, now heavy water is poisonous because you can't drink it. And in fact, if you was to fall into a vat of heavy water, you can just forget it. Even Tarzan or an Olympic swimmer couldn't swim out of it because the weight of it would just keep you down. And see, they use this in atomic reactors. This is how they control the atomic pile in a nuclear reactor because the neutrons that's being emitted by the radioactive pile is slowed down by the heavy water. See? And they have rods that they can stick inside called cadmiums, which absorbs the neutrons. So when they want the reactor to be low, they put the rods in there and it absorbs all the neutrons. But when they want the reactor to go up, they just pull the rods out and the neutrons go free and the reactor is up. See? But part of that is deuterium or D2O. Now look, there's John out here on the Isle of Patmos. He's surrounded by water. And when he heard the voice of Elohim come to him, see, he said he heard the sound of many waters. See, because why? Because see, you got pure spirit here. See, you got hydrogen here, and here you got deuterium here. See, all right? And so now here's the sound of many waters. All right, so now here's, now that's the second stage. Now the third stage you can go to is called, it's called tritium. And if you look at the word tri, that means three, or third. Now that is the next isotope from, in other words, you have two manifestations of the one element.
Very right? Good.
Just like you got two, physical and incorporeal, two manifestations of the one spirit.
Right.
That's what's being manifested with hydrogen. You got two manifestations of, and look at tritium, see, tritium is a radioactive isotope. In fact, years ago, a lot of people didn't know this, but years ago, back in the 60s, they used to take a very minute amount of tritium, and they used to put it in fluorescent paint, and they used to put it on the watches. So, like, you know, if you got a watch that glowed in the dark from back in the 60s, more than likely, it had a little, just a little speck of tritium in it. It made it glow. That's why you could see it in the dark.
Yeah.
Well, see, that's like Yahshua the Messiah. And we got him painted down here among this darkness, but we could see him. Why? Because why? Isn't he the light of the world?
Yeah.
Isn't he glowing in the dark?
Yeah.
See what I'm saying? So you got two manifestations of the one spirit. And see, this is all in hydrogen. And see, and then from, and see, look, and you take astronomy or cosmology. See, because from tritium, you can go to this next element. Helium. See, and that's element number two here on the periodic table. This is what you're seeing here is the process by which the sun shines. Because what has to happen at the core of the sun, you got to have hydrogen, which changes into deuterium, which changes into tritium, which converts into helium, which produces a great amount of energy, which gives us light, energy, radiation, etc. This is why. And then somebody's going to say, well, Elohim is always in shape and form. Well, not according to nature. This is a transmutation here. Can't be. That's why I laugh at people and say, oh, Elohim is always in shape. I say, man, you don't know the 92nd atom. You ain't read Dr. Kinley's work. You haven't even scratched it. And that's the thing I say around here, because see, if you take the time and go back and just go into the things Dr. Kinley brought up, see, this is what people get hung up at. Well, I never heard Dr. Kinley say it. No, but Dr. Kinley laid the foundation for it so that you can come along, build on it, and say it yourself.
That's all right. Right.
That's right. All right.
That's what he was about. He wasn't afraid of somebody coming along and improving, you know, not so much improving what he did, but to more or less that it wasn't going by the pattern. But hey, his job was to set the thing up. Because I'll tell you, nobody's going to come along and supersede the seventh angel. That is impossible.
Right.
That is just not going to happen. The only thing you could do is just say, hey, well, look, you know, I took that which he gave me, man, and hey, this is what it is. Within this, and it's all within the cloud.
Right.
You ain't gonna come up with something outside the cloud. Oh, well, yeah, this. I got this. No, you're not. Oh, no, you're not. Not even. Not even. Okay. So now here you got this transmutation going on here, and now we got this here, this periodic table of elements. Now the reason why it's called a periodic table because it is based on what is called the periodic law, and the periodic law is this. See, anything that's periodical has to repeat itself. That's what the word period means. Something that, you know, on a regular interval or cycle. And that's what these things do. They repeat themselves. See, look, you got seven. See the lines going across, like this goes across, this goes across, this goes across, this goes across, this goes across. This is part of this. You see this little, see, that's part of this, but it's drawn out for a reason. But there are only seven periods. Why? Because this is a type of the tabernacle pattern. There's only seven steps in the pattern.
Right.
See? So now, when we look at this, and we look at, see now the one who came up, and let me say something about this. The guy that came up with this was a Russian scientist. His name was Dmitri Mendeleev back in the 19th century. And they thought he was crazy. Because he dreamed on this. And he said it himself that, you know, he dreamed on this. This was revealed to him in a dream. John 17? No, 3 and 17, isn't it? John 3 and 17, I think.
3 and 21.
3 and 21, thank you.
Maybe 27.
Okay.
John 3.
27, I think.
27.
John answered and said, a man can receive nothing except to be given him from heaven.
See now, that's what happened. See, this was revealed to this man in a dream. And for that matter, I don't care any scientists that come up with any major discovery, they didn't come up with it on their own.
Right.
It was revealed to them by Yahweh.
That's right.
See, and they say, well, you know, like somebody might discover, well, this is Ohm's law. Well, Ohm didn't come up with it. Ohm just was the one that Yahweh allowed to see, or he revealed it to, and he was allowed to explain it.
Right.
See?
Right.
So now it's called Ohm's law. Newton didn't come up with the laws of motion, but Yahweh allowed Isaac Newton to see the principle when he dropped the apple. Who do you think made the apple drop on his head?
Yeah.
To make him see that.
Right.
That was Yahweh that did that. It's all Yahweh's law, but we know, Ohm's law, Newton's law of motion, and this, because Yahweh allowed that individual to research and study, and in all cases, he just simply revealed it to them.
Yes.
So now, likewise, with Mendeleev. At that time, there were only, 67 elements at that time. And when this was revealed to him, that it was shown that these elements go by a pattern, he predicted the existence of three more elements that was going to come. He showed them and said, this is where it's going to be. This is how many protons. This is the atomic number, how many protons it'll be. This will be the atomic weight. And it'll be in this slot. And they thought he was crazy. They said, man, what kind of gypsy science is this? But when it happened, the people had to stop and look. They said, wait a minute, here, there's some principles that we didn't overlook here. There's a law going on here. See, there's a pattern going on here. There's a purpose going on here. That's how they're able, see, as we said, there are 92 natural elements. Elements 93 on up, see, these are called artificial elements because they're created. See, they're created in cyclotrons, nuclear reactors, particle accelerators. And the reason why they can create these elements is because they've had 92 examples to look at. You see? Now, let's just look at this. Now, this is color-coded to show that these elements are related to each other. They're in families, okay? All right? So therefore, they have similar traits and characteristics, okay? Where is that? Acts 17:24?
Yeah. Acts 17:24. Yahweh, who made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is ruler of heaven and earth, he dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things, and hath made of one man all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek him, if happily they might feel after him, and find him, though he be not far from every one of us.
So now he said, determine the bounds, appointed the bounds of their habitation. That's what these. That's why this is color-coded. These elements are in their, they're in their habitation as Yahweh ordered them. And and they have these traits. For example, this little blue column here. This is called noble gases. These are gases like helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, and radon. Now, they are called noble gases because they are inert. That means that they don't do anything. They don't react with nothing. They are at rest, as you will. That's their characteristic. That's their family trait. Just like you got families, some families are just, they have characteristic traits. Some families can sing real good or musical. Another families are very good carpentry or mechanics, My family, man, we like to argue. We can argue, boy. We can argue up and down a storm. Don't matter if we're right or wrong. We just love to argue. I got an older brother. You get into an argument with him, you're going to be talking to the black Mr. Spock, boy. I ain't arguing with him even to this day. The only time I ever won an argument with him was when I talked to him about this gospel. That's the only time I ever won an argument with my brother. Anything else, I lose because he's so logical. But when it comes to the gospel, he couldn't say nothing then, see? But that's what they are. That's their traits, okay? Now, because they're non-reactive, they represent the most non-reactive elements in the universe. And just like Hebrew, which is written from right to left, when you go from right to left here, the more from right to left you go, the more active the elements become until you come to this particular column. See, this is called alkaline metals. See, elements like lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, and francium. These represent some of the most reactive elements in the universe. For example, if you was to take just a little pinch of potassium and drop it in a glass of water, you would have the biggest explosion you'd ever want to see in this room. Because that's how reactive it is.
Wow.
See? Now, hydrogen, now Elohim, see, before I get into that, let me say this. Now, Elohim, see, You know, when he said he reached back, as was brought out, he didn't reach back into this cloud. He reached back within himself.
Right.
And listen, it didn't take a whole bunch of Elohim to create this universe. In fact, all he needed was just enough to create or transmute into one hydrogen atom.
That's right.
And that's all he had to do. And see, look, that's how you came into this world. You started off as one cell. See? See when that egg is fertilized? See? There's an ovum here. See? See, that's an ovum. And then the sperm fertilizes the egg. Tail breaks off. But even at that, even when the sperm is in there, there's still a state where it's still considered one cell. See? And then once that fertilization becomes, it turns into a zygote. See, and the process it goes is mitosis. That means cell division. See, and once this process of mitosis goes, 4 becomes 8, 8 becomes 16, then a billion, then billions of cells later, here you are. It's the same way with the universe. It started off with one atom. And look, he couldn't say no more than, well, look, that's not what you start off with, one atom. Yeah. And he split an atom. He split an atom. One became two. Yeah. Two became four because they had Cain and Abel. You know what I'm saying? And the next thing you know, hey, you got a whole population on the earth here. But it started from one atom. It's the same way the universe started with one atom. And look, he couldn't tell the atom, the hydrogen atom, no more than he would tell them, hey, be fruitful and multiply. It's the same difference. It's nothing changed, nothing new. It's all repetition. See? And that's what happened here. Yahweh Elohim transmuted in part into one hydrogen atom, and then this one hydrogen atom became the rest of these elements, because as Dr. Kim explained it, it became this amalgamated conglomeration of a coring mass.
Yeah.
But it's got to start from somewhere. It had to start with one hydrogen atom.
Yeah.
That's where it started from. It's right here on the chart. And even in the panoramic vision pamphlet, Dr. Kim said he witnessed.
Right. Crystallized.
Crystallized. That the hydrogen atom crystallized in front of him. Why? Because the hydrogen atom is in, hey, it's in the image and likeness of Elohim. Because this is the hydrogen atom. Hey, what did it say? A proton and electron, which represents the angelic and the physical creation. Well, here's Elohim here. He's incorporeal. That represents the angelic creation. He's standing on the earth. That represents the physical creation. That's the original hydrogen atom. And this is in the midst of the invisible third part, which is spirit law.
Uh-huh.
That's what you're looking at. That's what you're looking at when you look at this. Now, here's that, and we showed you how the hydrogen in the process of the sun goes from, you know, hydrogen to deuterium, tritium, then helium. So now here's helium, and so now here is the pattern, because we showed you, all right? Now we told you, see, about these elements down here, right? They were the most reactive, right? Remember we said that? Right, so now that would be like the court roundabout. That would be like the brazen altar of sacrifice. Right? So now here's the brazen offering sacrifice. And then we gotta come over here, because here's these two rows. Now this is what is called the lanthanide series, talking about the first row, and the second row is called the actinide series, because both of these, okay, because this one is funded by lanthanum, and this is funded by actium. Now lanthanum is a Latin word, and it means hidden. See? See why? Because it's a type of a burial. See, that's what's happening here. And then here you have actinum. See, because actinum is found in a mineral called pitchblende. That's a German word which means pitch black, or darkness. See, why there's darkness here. So here you gotta have a manifestation of darkness here. Now here we got past element 92, you got 93, all the way up to 103. These are the artificial elements. In other words, these are elements that really, they have to materialize them out of spirit in a type. Because they don't exist in the earth. I mean, you are not going to go out here and dig up some Einsteinium out in the ground or any of these elements. You're not going to find it because they're too unstable. All right? Huh?
You know, what did you say the actinum was? You said lanthanum.
Lanthanum means hidden. Actinum is found in a mineral called pitchblende. And that means pitch black. See, a darkness. Somebody's pitch back. Okay. So now here you got these elements here. See, in other words, they exist in a type in the spirit. Talking about elements past uranium. Because you don't see them. That would be a type of the cup of holy anointing oil. Because that's a type of spirit. See? So now we go back here. So now that's the court roundabout right here. They've taken this and taken this. Now we turn it back upside down. This little colored area here, this would be like the holy place. See? Now we know in the holy place you got a light, a bread, and a lampstand. I mean, intercessor for intercessor. So now you have to look for those principles. Now within this column, here are different elements. Like for example, what is it at? This one right here. One that says W. That's the chemical symbol for tungsten. Why? Because tungsten is used for light filaments. See, so that's a type. See, remember, this is the holy place. That's a type of the lampstand. All right? And then we got another element here. We got Fe. See that one right there? That's the chemical symbol for iron. That's a type of the table of shewbread. Why? Because, see, don't they say you got to have your daily iron, your daily sustenance? You run down, you got iron poor blood. You can use, you can do, one a day, some geritol or something, get your daily sustenance. All right? Now we come up here, because we're going up. We're going up now. All right? So now we got this element here, Zn. That stands for zinc. Right? That would be right here at the altar of incense. Why? Because zinc, if you know anything about zinc is good for respiratory problems. You know, you got a good cold, a chest cold or something. Hey, I got a bottle of zinc at home. When I get a chest cold, I get congested, I start sucking on them zinc tablets. Because that's good for your respiratory. Why? Because that's a type there, see? That's a type of a mediator, intercessor. All right? Then we come up here, see, with this little green area, right? We got this element six, that's carbon. See, six points to the flesh. This is like the veil here. See? And now within this green area, there are different elements. Now, for example, next to carbon, you got nitrogen and oxygen, and they make up the bulk of this atmosphere. All right? And so when the sun shines through the atmosphere on a clear day, what does the sky look like?
Blue.
Blue. Why? Because that's one of the colors of the curtain on the sixth step. And then you got this other one. This one, I, for iodine. What does iodine mean?
Purple.
And then you got another element in this green area called bromide. If you ever look at the element bromide, the color of bromide is red. So within this green area, carbon, and you got the principle of blue, purple, and scarlet. See? Or the veil. And then we're back up to where we started, right? Remember, we started with these noble gases, right? That don't do anything. Why? Because they're at peace. They're at rest. See, that's like the most holy place. See? Now look, and they don't interact with anything. Now there is one exception.
Uh-huh.
This element here called neon. See, neon will react with one thing and one thing only, and that's electricity. Because electricity will cause neon to glow. Why? Because that would be like the flash of the Shekinah.
Okay, all right.
See, that's what we're talking about. See, now Dr. Kinley never talked about it, but Dr. Kinley set up the foundation for it to find out.
Yeah.
And you know why? Because look, when John was out here on the Isle of Patmos, see, remember, seven thunders was uttered toward him, if you remember. And then John started to write, remember?
Right.
And then John would say, don't write.
Right.
Why? I got Moses handling it.
Uh-huh.
Dr. Kinley could have wrote about this, but he was told not to. Uh-huh. Why? I got Mendeleev on this. However, Dr. Kinley, I will let you write about the hydrogen atom.
Uh-huh.
And if anybody has got any sense, they will follow your instructions. They will follow the path led out by that. Because when you look at this periodic table of elements, this is the same thing in principle as this chart, as well as all the other charts.
Yeah.
Because it's by the pattern. And that's the things that we're talking about. We're not, what we're talking about is taking these things that are found and laid out and building on them. And this school should have been, the dreams he had for the school could have been, but people just, what can I say? It's all Yahweh's purpose, sure enough.
Yeah.
But it has to be that way so that Yahweh can show his power. Just like down here, it looked like the Israelites didn't have a chance. You know, and in fact, Dr. Kinley said about Pharaoh down there, he said, Pharaoh was too soft. I had to toughen him up some. Look how hard his heart. I had to toughen this guy up some. So I have to prove you.
Yeah.
To prove Israel.
Yeah.
To prove you. Hey, bring me gold, try and fire.
Yeah.
That's what that's about.